Welcome to From Newcastle, a podcast featuring the latest developments in health, science, and culture and the creative arts from Newcastle University. In this special mini-series, From Newcastle for Healthcare, we find out about how our medical research is being used to develop solutions to real-life challenges. Hi, I'm Robyn, and you're listening to From Newcastle. Today, I'll be talking to Dr Susan Bisse, Lecturer of Dentistry here at Newcastle University, and Claire Hills-Wilson, Artistic Director of the Lawnmowers Independent Theatre Company. In this episode, we will learn about a collaboration between the Lawnmowers Theatre Group and Newcastle University's School of Dentistry. In a special project, they worked together to create an educational film to help inform dental students on the process of treating patients with learning difficulties. So, hi, welcome Claire and Susan. It's great to have you on the From Newcastle podcast today. Please, could you both introduce yourself and give a short overview of your work?
Hi, my name is Susan Bissett. So I am the Deputy Programme Director for the BSc in Oral and Dental Health Sciences, which is the programme that teaches people to be dental therapists. I'm also a clinical lecturer and I've been working in research for the past 14 years. I'm an academic dental hygienist. I started off 14 years ago working in research, delivering the clinical necessities of a project. And then I started to manage a research facility that we have. And also I got the opportunities to do some higher degrees and I'm now a clinical lecturer with a teaching and research contract. So I'm also an oral and dental speciality group lead, which is for this region, and that's a National Institute of Health and Care Research role. And I'm also involved in the teaching on our two dental undergraduate programmes, so that's the dental therapists and the dental students. And I'm also involved in patient and public involvement in research, which I do as a lead role for the Newcastle Biomedical Research Centre.
Amazing, thank you. And Claire?
That's extensive, isn't it? Wow. So my name is Claire Hills-Wilson. I'm the Artistic Director of Lawnmowers Theatre Company. So Lawnmowers Theatre Company is a theatre company run by, for and with adults with learning disabilities. We were set up in 1986. So we've got a long-standing history within the North East. And Lawnmowers exists to create change. And our mission statement is that people with learning disabilities can be active citizens, visible artists and agents of change.
Can you both tell us a little bit about your background and what got you into this area of work?
So I did an applied theatre degree at Northumbria University, and the application of the theatre was all around creating awareness or education to look at or address issues or look at, you know, sort of create awareness about different themes and subject matters. And I went to Lawnmowers Theatre in my third year of that degree and was blown away about the application of how they were using theatre, and came across Theatre of the Oppressed and Forum Theatre and how they use the arts to create change and sort of address issues, and got a little bit hooked with that. And I was first at Lawnmowers as a self-employed artist and kind of kept going away and coming back to different projects with them. And then it sort of took over my life a little bit, if I'm honest, and I became artistic director with Lawnmowers in 2014. And Research Abilities, which is the group that we linked in with Newcastle University, launched in 2020. And the use of arts in research is really new, but very exciting for Lawnmowers. And I'm sure we'll go into that a little bit later on.
Susan, what inspired this collaboration?
It was probably 2019 when the Lawnmowers hosted an engagement event, really showcasing their creative health awareness training programme that they do with Northumbria University and other educational institutions. And this was a theatre piece that illustrated the problems that adults with learning disabilities can have in accessing medical care. Now, at that time, we had received some funding to deliver some research at Newcastle University about the barriers to accessing dental care for adults with learning disabilities. And I thought that this was such a powerful way to articulate those barriers, and wondered whether myself and Claire could collaborate on the project that we're talking about today. Historically, dental services have been, for certainly for people with severe learning disabilities, have been in community dental services. So adults with learning disabilities, which are on the more moderate to severe, would get referred to community services. But it's considered that actually primary care, so your high street dental practice, is a really good place for those with mild to moderate learning disabilities. And certainly research has shown, our research showed, that the number of referrals of these patients to community services and hospital services is increasing over the recent years. Now, in 2019, some research that we did at Newcastle University showed that our dental undergraduates have varied levels of confidence and experience in working with adults with learning disabilities. So really, this population is considered that they require like specialist care, specialist skills, longer appointments, etc., but also staff with additional qualifications to treat them. And again, we feel like that isn't the case, and that adults with learning disabilities, which are on the mild to moderate area, can really very well and adequately and comfortably and well be treated in primary care, which could be around the corner from somebody's home. So in 2020, the GDC published some recommendations that said that dental students and other new dental graduates or dental therapy undergraduates should actually be trained more in being able to confidently and efficiently manage the care of people with special needs, of which adults with learning disabilities would fit into that group.
The collaboration happened when we met at a researchers' lunch that we held at Lawnmowers, and we already have sort of a decade's worth of practice in sort of creating change and doing awareness training programmes with the CHAT programme, which is Creative Health Awareness Training. And unbeknownst to me, the literature that, you know, Susan's just sort of articulated was a reason that we could work in the style that we were used to, creating awareness through theatre and supported by the recommendations and the literature that Susan had. We knew that there was a collaboration that we could sort of do together, and dentistry was an area that we hadn't tapped into, and we hadn't appreciated the health inequality that ran through dentistry services. So enter the Lawnmowers and Susan with Newcastle University to sort of, you know, have that collaboration together.
Can you talk us through the process of creating a video like this, especially with the use of real-life dental labs and university equipment?
So initially, we started off with a project that was funded through the Department of Health and Social Care, so NHS England, NHS Improvement, and that was to speak to all the different stakeholders involved in delivering and accessing dental care for this population group. So we held the workshops, and then we took the data and we delivered a report back to our funders, and we decided between the two of us that the aim of the film would be, and subsequent small group discussion that we're going to have afterwards, was to raise awareness in our undergraduate population of dental therapists and dental students of the barriers that adults with learning disabilities can experience when accessing dental care, and enhance their communication skills, their confidence, and improve their preparedness to meet these patients' individual needs. So my research project is this how we've actually gone about this now. This has been funded through the Newcastle University Faculty of Medical Sciences Education, Development and Research Programme. I obtained ethics approval through Newcastle University Ethics Committee. Then I had to liaise with the Head of Communications in Newcastle upon Tyne Hospital's NHS Foundation Trust to get approval to actually film on the site, and also the permissions of the manager of the School of Dental Sciences, again, so that we could access the different locations that we wanted to for the film.
So what are some of the locations that you used in the film?
We filmed a lot of it actually here in Newcastle University's digital media team site. So that was fantastic. We were able to create mock-ups of dental reception areas, staff coffee rooms.
They were very creative, the team.
Incredibly creative.
Creating that space and those different scenes to reflect everybody in the data. You know, there was community reception and community dental service. Then there was high street reception and high street dental service. So very similar, but we had to sort of make them look like different locations. And the team were amazing at sort of being accommodating to that. So I think the film was really important to show the barriers within the systems that we can't easily change or create reasonable adjustments for people with learning disabilities within the system that they currently operate. And that was what was coming through very much so in the piece. And I felt, and having a conversation with Susan in, you know, meetings and things, I would say I would love to armour the students coming through the services to be those agents of change. How do they, you know, set up systems, or how do they create change within the system that they're operating in to best serve that person with a learning disability? And, you know, the next step for this possibly would be to talk to clinical commissioners off the back of the film and say, how can we create that change that supports these people coming into this service to create better care for people with learning disabilities? But I think having that awareness and, like you say, armouring them with the tools and sort of the film is the first step to that for us.
Can you explain some of the ways in which people with learning difficulties would need to have special or catered dental assistance as opposed to someone without?
So I think it's important to say that this research was done in the northeast of England. So as a sort of disclaimer, this is our findings. We can't say that this is generalisable to other areas of the UK or beyond. However, our research revealed that adults with learning disabilities do value their oral health. They understand the significance of oral hygiene, the impact of sugar on their dental health, and the importance of oral health to their systemic health. And the barriers occur when they try to access dental health services. So these barriers, these would be helped if they were able to have some reasonable adjustments made. In that, I'm talking about maybe longer appointments, enhanced communication skills, so that they are empowered to be able to articulate their dental concerns in a more accommodating way. And this means, of course, longer appointments, and that is a problem when you come to dental commissioning. We found out through the focus groups that whereas medical primary care practitioners can make reasonable adjustments, it's much harder for dentists and dental therapists to make those adjustments. And this is something that we're hoping to improve, because small adjustments can be made that aren't going to lead to a big problem financially for people delivering care. And we're hoping that this raises awareness and improves things moving forward.
One thing that alarmed me in the focus group data was the importance or the sort of emphasis that was put upon UDA's unit of dental activity. If someone with a learning disability needs two appointments to have one filling, whereas you or I might need one, that's seen as a failing maybe on the high street because they've took two appointments as opposed to one, but that might be what that person needs. And I hadn't appreciated that the referral system, when you make a referral to community, is for one particular part of that person's oral care. It's not overall. So it's not very holistic. It's very unit based. It's very time orientated. And I hope, as a director, I got that across in some of the scenes that we created. And what was amazing was that the actors with learning disabilities were able to understand the system pressures by embodying those roles and those characters and having the suits of power on and sort of showing that through characters and, you know, that sort of pressure and needing to do more and quicker and faster and better. And it was very much an eye-opener for us and not a part of health inequalities that we appreciated existed, yet we know there is a massive link between poor oral hygiene and people with learning disabilities. Having that data in front of us made us understand why.
Although we've talked about the barriers that adults with learning disabilities face and also the oppression in the system, there was a lot of frustration on the part of dental professionals that they couldn't do better, do more, have longer appointments. They were frustrated by that as well.
Absolutely, that came through massively, especially within community, when they would get somewhere with somebody and they would have that more holistic sort of freedom with, that the system may not operate in High Street. And you could see that people were so frustrated with the pressure that was on them, post-COVID. I really wanted to see that change for them and sort of think, well, what's our call response as an organisation that fights for social justice for people with learning disabilities? What can we do? We can create an awareness film, but then there feels like there needs to be something around system change to support that. But the film's our first step, I suppose.
Yeah, the film is a very good first step in achieving some of these goals. Now we're going to hear from Andrew and Ginger, two actors from the Lawnmower Theatre Group who are in the film. They explain why the creation of these educational videos is so important to training dentists.
I think dental students should watch this film because it's to help people with learning disabilities gain easier access to the dentistry services.
I think this work is important for the dentistry students and the dental therapy students because, you know, if they see this film, then they'll be able to look at it and work out what should be better and then work on that to take into their professions. Because as we know, people with learning disabilities tend to have quite a bad rap in a lot of the medical professions when they want to see doctors and dentists and what have you. So I think this film can really give legs to make changes in the future. It'll give them something to really sink their teeth into.
So Claire, what did you think to Andrew and Ginger's comments?
Well, apart from Andrew's little pun, I don't know if you caught that there, sink their teeth into. My actors are all about creating change. It's why they do what they do when they come to Lawnmowers, and a lot of them have been there for 15 plus years. They're really dedicated to creating change for people with learning disabilities. And they'll always say, if one person can change what they do from my lived experience, then that's my job done. And I think they both articulate well sort of the need for this resource. It's, you know, it's creating change on the back of lived experience and people's actual verbatim comments in a focus group and thinking, okay, what can we do with this? What can we create and make a better, you know, NHS dental service going forward? It is slightly different, however, to usual, because normally it's always their lived experience as actors that they sort of portray on stage. Whereas this time around, we had viewpoints and professionals and sectors that we hadn't appreciated existed possibly, you know, within the clinical commissioners, the community dentists. And we had to embody and sort of become those people that we might not have had lived experience of. And that was really nice artistically for us, you know, to have that challenge, but also to have that power shifted. You know, here the guys were in gowns and they were in sort of dentistry uniforms that society wouldn't allow them to be those people. And yet they embodied and created a character that was that person. So it was really political, even just seeing them in the dentistry suites with those, you know, gowns and those scrubs on, being those characters that at the minute they can't be because of the barriers that are around people with learning disabilities. As a director, I was very conscious on set when we were filming, creating the script, constantly giving it back and forward to Susan. And it was invaluable having Susan on set because I kept saying, is this reality? Does this reflect practice? You know, should we keep that line in? And it was, you know, usually a researcher leaves us and we have that creative flair ourselves. But having Susan in the filming throughout the whole week was just invaluable because it had to reflect reality and practice in order for it to create change for us and have that real authenticness of the system that they're going into.
I felt like from the workshops that we did, then looking back at the transcripts from the workshops, then delivering, you know, working on the storyboard with you, I felt like there were some heartbreaking quotes and experiences that came through. the hope is, I mean, they really understand that now, don't they? They understand the full 360 of the issues. Obviously, they've had their own experiences, but then they understand the constraints that are in the system. It is a system problem. It's also a person problem, you know, in terms of how much we can educate our undergraduates to be able to deliver that care better.
The Lawnmowers Theatre Company is centred around catering towards people with learning difficulties. Why do you think it's so important to have representation of people with learning difficulties featured in the educational videos?
I think we've touched upon it in terms of Armour and the Dentists of Tomorrow with that information and that awareness. And we always see people who care or support people with learning disabilities as agents of change. You know, like what within their agency have they got to change the system and to create that change, be it people or system change. But I think there was a real political nature to having the guys on set and to creating this film, that you get to see people with learning disabilities acting abilities. You get to see the comprehension of the information that they are articulating on screen. You know, Debbie plays a general practice manager of a high street firm, and she's talking about UDAs and can we move this person on to community and can we send a referral, and she's using jargon and words that aren't her words, aren't her sort of life, but she understood the mechanics of what that manager would have to face on a day-to-day basis in order to move and shift and create change and work with what they had. And on the back of it, that armours us and sort of empowers us to understand the system that we're operating on, and then creates own agency for our own medical and dental journeys. I think the rollout to the students will be very political, because we will become their lecturers for the day. So they'll watch that video and then we'll be there in the lecture hall, or, you know, on Zoom, or however we decide to deliver it when we come to launch it. And you are really tackling people's preconceived ideas of what people with learning disabilities are capable of, and that unbiased conscience that you may not even know you have.
I think that it's you know, a person's experiences should be articulated by the person themselves. So we couldn't have done this without the Lawnmowers and all of the actors who took part, both participating in the research data collection and also working on this theatre piece, and also working with our students, which is what we're going to do next. So I think that's very powerful. But I also think that the voices of the dental professionals who want to do so much better and are struggling in a system are also very powerful too. So it's good that they've got this representation, because that probably isn't heard very often either.
Regarding future innovations in dental healthcare, where do you see improvements in healthcare specifically for people with learning difficulties heading?
So if I refer back to the 2020 published recommendations from the General Dental Council, that dental students and or new dental graduates should be better equipped to manage patients with special needs, I feel like this is one step in that direction. We're going to have eventually an e-learning product. So it will have, first of all, the film itself. And then we're recruiting, the next step is to recruit dental students and dental therapy students to take part in some research where we film them watching the film, so that we can see their expressions, and then we'll talk to them afterwards about how they can develop agency within themselves to make adjustments for this patient group and be able to deliver better dental care for them.
Absolutely.
So that is our next step. That will all be filmed, and then we will put that together. We're going to do some evaluation work afterwards with the students to see, you know, what they felt, whether they feel like it's doing enough or what else we can do. And then that will be launched potentially in National Smile Month, and also at a conference, dental conference, so that other dental schools can see this product and they can potentially also step in to talk to us about using it with their dental undergraduates as well.
Hanging it on to an awareness month like I Like My Smile Month gives us accountability but also awareness. It says, what are you doing for that month, or how are you creating a better future for people with learning disabilities within dental care? It gives people the tools to actually answer the question, rather than just it being a recommendation in a paper that maybe never gets actioned and people are scratching their heads on how do we create that change. So, with being a small theatre company, these awareness programmes are vital for our survival. You know, funding is very hard for organisations, and this creates revenue for us, and we can sustain ourselves long term by selling these products out, you know, to different universities as paid training opportunities.
This is a new step for you, am I right in saying, Claire? Because previously to certainly the pandemic, you were delivering in-person theatre workshops.
That's right, yeah. All of our face-to-face awareness training was done within the radius of Newcastle and Gateshead. You know, maybe Teesside and Sunderland was maybe as far as we could go, and Hexham and that sort of Northumberland was as far as we could sort of reach within a day. But we got very seasoned in the pandemic of doing Zoom workshops. So, and the fact that it's a digital film is even better. It's pre-recorded. We can show that, or we can have a link. Students can go off and watch that. Then we can have an interactive moment with the actors in that second hour on Zoom together, or Teams, or whatever platform we choose to use. And again, it just makes us more visible to more people. There's, you know, a lot of different dental schools across the UK. There's only one in the northeast, so it feels a bit luxurious to have one, you know, a resource just for one particular dentist school. And why be sort of territorial over it? Let's share this data. Let's, you know, try and armour as many dental students as possible with the information that we've got, if it creates change and, you know, a difference.
Yeah, it's all about dissemination, isn't it? In terms of research, it's about getting the word out there, and this is going to reach much further.
And Susan, from a Newcastle dentistry perspective, what do you think you've learned from this experience?
I think that there's a big need for reaching out to what we might call hard to reach groups. So people who aren't normally involved in research, people whose lives we find it difficult to actually speak to and find out about them and find out about their experiences. So this is a great experience for me to be able to do this. There's a lot of people interested in this work. Personally, meeting everybody, they're my friends now.
Yeah.
I go in and I see them, and they're just fantastic people. Love spending time with them. It was great spending a week filming here during the summer with them all. They're a fantastic group of people to work with. I'm so pleased to have been involved in this co-produced piece of work. I'm very, very proud of it. Yeah, I'm very proud of it indeed. I can't wait to, you know, show it to everybody. It's going to be such a great, great day, great time.
Absolutely. And I think what I love about it is Lawnmowers don't operate on an entry level at this. 1986 is when the company first started, 37 years ago. We come at this at a real deeper level of understanding the reports and the literature that sort of support that this is a health inequality that we then need to sort of get behind and create change around. And I think Susan has really illustrated when we put two things together and we create a reasonable adjustment, you know, a university that might sort of normally be in isolation working on what they do, a theatre company that might work in isolation doing what they do. When we blend those two things together, look at what we can create together. As a director, I honestly didn't understand why we were creating research abilities as a programme. Now I totally get it. The creative methods that we have at our disposal to create this data dissemination, to work on focus groups, to create a script from data, I really get why that works.
So Claire, how can our listeners find out more about the Lawnmowers and what you guys do?
Well, we have a website, lawnmowerstheatre.com, or we're on X at lawnmowersITC. We're on Facebook and Instagram, all the other socials that you would normally expect. Our YouTube channel shows some of these awareness training videos that we've talked about today. But if you are local to the area, we're in Peel or Gateshead. So come in and have a cup of tea in our arts centre.
Amazing. And finally, a question we like to ask all of our guests here on the podcast. What is your favourite thing about Newcastle?
I would say the history. So one of the things that I love to do is see the black and white photos of the streets of Bicker and those wonderful areas of Newcastle with the kids playing in the street and the families, and that real sense of the industry, the hard work that was done around the river.
I would say the diversity and culture. I think it's so varied. You can go into Newcastle City Centre and see some theatre, then go into the markets and have street food. It's just so vibrant and buzzing, but it doesn't ever feel too intimidating or overwhelming as a city. It feels safe and connected. It's like a little village. Everybody kind of knows each other in some ways, and that makes for brilliant networking.
We tend to say to our students, you know, it's from campus to the central station where you might come in on your train with all your bags. It's like 15 to 20 minute walk. So it is really easy to go everywhere in the city, isn't it? It's quite compact.
Amazing. Thank you so much for coming on the podcast.
Thank you.
Thank you for the invitation. It's been fantastic.
Thanks for having us.
Thank you for listening to this episode of From Newcastle. You can find useful links and information and listen to more at podcasts.ncl.ac.uk/from Newcastle. If you enjoyed this episode, then please click the subscribe button and leave us a review. If you have any comments, suggestions or questions, you can get in touch at fromnewcastlepodcast@ncl.ac.uk or via social media at fromnclpodcast. From Newcastle is a production by Newcastle University.